Have you ever wondered how games create those satisfying laser beams that stop exactly where they hit something? The secret lies in one technique, raycasting. This same technique powers many cool game mechanics, from Link's grappling hook in Zelda to the mining beam in No Man's Sky, and even teleportation markers in games like Dishonored. In a few minutes, you'll learn how to combine a raycast with visual effects to create this satisfying beam weapon for your own 2D games. Let's dive in. To code a laser, you'll have two main parts working together. A raycast 2D node that handles the logic and physics. It'll detect what the laser hit and where. Visual effects that show the beam and the impact as they vary based on the raycast data. You can think of the raycast as the brain of our laser and the visuals as the body. The brain probes the world to decide how far the laser goes, and the body adapts to show exactly that. We're able to make this video thanks to motivated learners who support GDQuest by investing in our one-of-a-kind, in-depth study program. GDQuest's 2D and 3D foundational courses form an extensive, guided learning pathway that's focused on Godot and boosted by unique interactive edtech. It's already helped thousands of game devs break free from step-by-step tutorials to really gain independence in their game projects. So, what exactly is a raycast? It's like an invisible line that the physics engine uses to detect the first object it touches. It's like pointing a laser pointer in your game world and looking at what it hits. A raycast is actually a vector, so you can control both its length and direction. Ledge detection, projectiles, lasers, AI lines of sight, raycasts hide behind many game mechanics as they're both versatile and lightweight. In Godot, we can use the raycast 2D node to create and control a raycast. It has one key property named target position, which controls how far and in what direction the ray extends. By default, the raycast is enabled to automatically report collisions every frame. You can toggle this behavior off with the enabled property. I'll show you how it's used in practice next. Like all GDQuest free tutorials from now on, this video will have an associated page in the GDQuest free library. There, you will find code references, demo files, FAQs, and bonuses such as juicing techniques, visual effects, and pro tips and tricks. When implementing a raycast for a laser, three key aspects come into play: the ray's origin and orientation, how it extends and retracts, the collision information it provides. The laser is a scene that starts with a raycast 2D node at its root. We can animate the raycast to extend and retract by incrementing its target position.x property in code. This only changes the ray's length. Then, once we attach it to a weapon or this spaceship, it will automatically rotate with the parent node. Let's look at the code. The laser raycast 2D node has a script attached to it. In the script, I want to animate the ray so it doesn't immediately snap to its maximum length. I want to create a smooth animation effect when the player fires the laser. I define two exported variables to control the laser's maximum length and casting speed. With this, we can animate the ray's target position.x property. The line extends the ray to the right each frame by a small amount controlled by the cast speed variable. The move toward function prevents the ray from extending beyond its maximum length. This code should only run when firing the laser, so I introduce a property with a setter function to toggle physics processing on and off. When turning off casting, you want to stop physics processing too to avoid any risk of later drawing or moving visual effects when the laser isn't firing. Lastly, in the setter function, I reset the ray's length to zero when the laser stops firing. This resets the laser and allows it to extend again the next time the player fires. With the raycast handling the laser's behavior, we now need to draw it on screen. To draw the lines and curves, you can use a Line2D node. It gives you many options to customize the ray's appearance with gradients, textures, and more. You'll find a few examples in the GDQuest free library. I've added the Line2D node as a child of the raycast2D. This way, it will move and turn with the ray. The node needs two points, one at the origin, 0, 0, and another that will move based on the raycast's length and collision information. I created the points in the inspector to make sure the line is straight. By default, the line is square and sharp, which doesn't look great for a laser. You can give it rounded caps at both ends by setting the capping, begin cap mode, and end cap mode properties to round. The line's color is set to white by default, and I often keep it that way. You can change the node's modulate property to change the color of the line. In the laser script, I export a variable to control the line's color with a setter function. With the tool annotation added at the top of the script, the color property will be updated in the editor as well. There are two reasons to expose a color property. You can easily change the color of the laser in the inspector for different lasers in your game. You can later use this property to keep the color of multiple visual effects in sync. Pro tip, don't forget to call your setter functions in the ready function. Exported variables are set when the node is ready, meaning before the line node is available in the scene tree. For the line to accurately represent our raycast, it needs to know where the ray ends, either at its maximum length or at a collision point. This code updates the line's second point to match the raycast. When the ray hits something, we convert the collision point to local coordinates, which ends the line exactly where the raycast hit. The force raycast update call is important. It gives us up-to-date collision information without the one-frame delay that could occur if the raycast's enabled property was set to true. With this call, we control exactly when the raycast updates and get the most accurate information. A static line appearing and disappearing instantly would look jarring. We can animate the line's width to create a more polished look. A fraction of a second is enough to make the effect smooth. I went with two functions named simply appear and disappear. The first one is called when the player starts firing the laser, and the second one when they stop in the setIsCastingSetter function. The appear function animates the line growing to its full width using a tween. If a previous tween animation is already running, it's stopped to prevent artifacts. Similarly, the disappear function animates the line shrinking back to no width. It also hides the line once the animation is done. The tween's twin callback function takes a function as an argument and runs it in sequence with the animation. In this case, after it finishes shrinking. With that, the beam appears, extends to its collision point or maximum length, and then smoothly disappears when the player stops firing. But how does the player fire the laser? We just need to change the laser's isCasting property when the player presses a button. In the spaceship script, I make the ship look at the mouse and fire the laser when the player presses the fire button. And there you have it! But what really sells the laser beam effect is the particle systems. They add energy and movement to what would otherwise be just a boring static line. For this laser, the glow post-processing effect and three particle systems work together to create the final result. The energy source particles, the impact particles, and the beam particles. To find out how to recreate these cool visual effects, consult this video's full entry in the GDQuest free library. It includes everything you need to reuse this laser and make it your own or recreate it from scratch, as well as answers to some of your questions. Be sure to also check out the Raycast Study Guide, a new entry in the free library giving you a nice overview of how to set up and use raycasts in Godot. And with that, I'll see you in the next tutorial.